presidente de uno de los países que han mostrado un fuerte interés en los últimos años en la mejora de la educación y la investigación, y de uno de los 15 países considerados cuna de la humanidad. Desde Emiratos Árabes Unidos nos acompaña el señor Ali Ribai. Es consultor en estrategia de gestión de la información y la arquitectura, así como del manejo de grandes volúmenes de datos. Sí, señores, vamos a darle un aplauso para recibir y acoger en este recinto al señor Ali Ribai.
Gracias. Buenos días. It's a pleasure being here today on the Big Data Mundial, and it's a pleasure for me to be in Bogota. I'm sorry to speak English. Big Data is everywhere. Even now we have music bands that's called Big Data. This is a music band in the US, it's called Big Data. There is a big hype when it comes to Big Data. Big Data is affecting our lives, it's affecting the way we work and everything, and there is no industry untapped by Big Data. I do travel a lot, I deliver keynotes about Big Data in different countries worldwide, and you know, whenever you want to go to a country, you research about its culture, about its trends, about people's interests. And how we do it? We mainly go to Google, we search about that, or even we ask our friends. But to me, as a data scientist, I said I should use Big Data to know about Bogota. So what I did, I scraped Instagram images for 1 month period in Bogota, and I analyzed the co-occurrence of hashtags on Instagram, and then I visualized them on this graph. What does this graph mean? The circles are the hashtags, and the connections and the edges and the connection are the co-occurrence of Instagram hashtags. So if you can see in here, I was able to spot the hashtags that are occurring in Bogota, and I was able to know people's interest in Bogota and what are the cultural trends in Bogota, and then I had this map. I was able to know that graffitis are everywhere. I was able to know that fashion, beauty is important in Bogota. I also know about tattoos. People love tattoos in Colombia. Also, Colombian coffee is one of the best in the world. Corona beer was trending also on Instagram. Chicle, goma de mascar, the bubble gum. I know that you love that as well. The nightclubs, folklore festivals. Colombia is well known for its festival. Also, I was able to know about Parque Nacional, mountains, tourism. I was able to spot all these trends via big data by visualizing Instagram hashtags. Instead of me going to Google or ask friends, I was able to conclude all of that using big data. So imagine how big data has opened for us and new opportunities in the future. And then I did my research and I discovered that all these trends were there in Bogota. So there are tons of tattoo conferences, Colombia, home of the perfect cup of coffee. Also, graffitis are everywhere in the streets. Also, I was able to spot the top university in Bogota, also using Instagram hashtags. Also about the Corona beer, Colombia's best club, and also beautiful women in Bogota, in Colombia, and also the trends when it comes to fashion, when it comes to fashion festivals in Colombia, and also the biggest carnival, which happens in Barranquilla, Colombia. I was able to spot all these by analyzing Instagram. By doing graph analysis, I was able to spot these trends. Moving forward, big data is moving us from predetermined questions, instead of setting what is the question I need to deduce, to narratives, to telling stories in data, which will help us answer questions we didn't know we had. I didn't know about all these trends. I had no questions in mind, and via big data, I was able to spot all these trends. And everything now can be based in a network. Behind each complex thing we have now can be put or constructed in a network or in a graph using the visualization I showed to you. You name it, like disease symptoms, graphs, sleeping patterns, telecom subscribers, all these, you can visualize them in a graph visualization, which is a new way of analyzing and visualizing data. Something like this graph, which is the Facebook connection worldwide. I'm not sure if you have seen this visualization before. And I've done the same when it comes to analyzing Instagram images. This is my Facebook network. And you can see the colors in here. The red color in the top down are my relatives. The orange color is the alumni friends in my university. And you can see the different friends I have and different communities and who are the influencers in my Facebook network. So now we can build these kind of visualizations. You can spot trends using graph visualizations. And we are moving to the big data age, starting from the hunter age, where the knife, the sparrow, the knife was the mean of success, moving to the agriculture age, then to the industrial age with factories, then to the information age, and now we are in a big data age where we should become empathizers and pattern recognizers. We are living in the age of big data ephemeralization. Ephemeralization is a term coined by a philosopher which says we can do things in our life with less and less materials until we eventually do everything with nothing. Imagine everything physically is decreased and everything data is becoming much more bigger. Let me give you an example. Moving to 1956, this is how we used to forklift 5 megabytes of data. Now with small flash modules, you can store huge amounts of data. Even the iPhone 6 now is 120 million times faster than Apollo, the computer that landed us to the moon. Imagine the processing and the computer power we have now. This is fabulous. Also, Boeing introduced last month a metal. This metal is 99.99% made of air. Imagine. So now if you are throwing an egg from a high floor, instead of putting a lot of metals in this egg, with this small metal, which is 99.9% made of air, you can throw it without crushing the egg. Also bees. Now there is a company that is putting RFID tags on the backpacks of bees in order to understand the patterns and how bees are moving. So they are able to know how animals, how insects, how everything in this world is now traced. It's now traced by big data. This is what I meant by pattern recognition. Also, if you go to Disneyland, you will wear these wearable devices, and it will track everything you do in Disneyland, everything you eat, everything you shop, everything you ride. So Mickey Mouse will come to your kids and say, "Happy birthday." He will speak about Jack Sparrow, who is a character in Pirates of Caribbean, because he already knew that your kids were playing Pirates of Caribbean in Disneyland. This is called traces. This is how we are tracing everything in big data. This is how we are reinventing customer experience management. When it comes to storing data, this is how we used to store data. That was in the Mesopotamian and Egyptian civilization 5,000 years ago. We used to store data in clay tablets. So when it comes to storing data, it's not something new. It's not about the huge amounts of data. It's about what we do with it. We can store data in the traditional databases or the relational databases, but it's not the right way to store the new data sources we have now. Data is coming in unstructured from sensors, from machines, from drones, from social media. So the traditional way of storing data is not the right way. That's why we have a new big data technologies. We have a technology called Hadoop, which is an open source technology that can help you store petabytes of information. And we have a different set of big data technologies. Most of them are named by animal names. So we have Hadoop, we have Spark, we have Tez, we have Impala, and different technologies to help us store, process, and analyze and visualize data. When it comes to analytics, what we can do with analytics? We can match patterns, find the data that sticks out, that doesn't match a normal profile or behavior. We can also predict the future, what is most likely to happen. We can describe relationships and connections. We can diagnose, like, why this happened. We can also simulate, know what could happen. We can also prescribe what is the action I should take next. Okay, you predicted that for me, but tell me, what is the action I need to take next? All these can be solved via analytics. Also, we need to transform education. The way we used to study in our universities, like go and memorize your books, it's not the right way now. Because, you know, information is everywhere. We can access information at our fingertips in seconds. So it's not the right way to memorize information. We are moving to artificial intelligence, which will take care of that in the future. And now machines will be able to understand us via our traces and provide us with contextual personalized services. So imagine you wake up in the morning, you get your phone, automatically Instagram and Facebook will open. Then when you have your coffee, then you hold your phone and automatically it will show for you the schedule for your day. And then when you go to take your bus to go to your work, automatically your phone will recognize that and open for you the transportation application. So the phone or the machine will be able to understand you, understand the context, the place, the time, and provide you with real-time, contextual, personalized service. We are part of this data revolution. We as humans, we are one of the most important parts of this revolution. Our personality traits, our memory, our emotions, our thoughts, everything we like, our interests, all these are important in the big data loops and the big data loop and the human generated data. And this is how we collect human data. No, I'm kidding. Human data is collected via everything, with your phone, with the sensor, with everything you are doing. Everything is now traced, your location, whatever you do, your interest is now traced in order to provide you with better services and better experience. And this is how we party now. So we hold our phones, and everything we do is now tracked, everything we do is now traced. And this is how we enjoy our moment. We take our phone and we put the sunset on Instagram. So everything now is changing. The way we behave is changing. This is a visualization for bird sounds. So even bird sounds can be visualized, everything will be traced, everything we do, even with animals, with we as humans, will be visualized. And we need to return back to the aha moment. That was in the campfire, the caveman age, where we used to sit around campfires. How were wise leaders selected at that time? Some people at that time used to sit, look at the stars, look at the constellation, and see how the seasons change, how the times change, how the stars are moving, and they are able to predict that the spring season will come next. So they go to the tribe and they tell them, in 1 month, spring will come. Then when this prediction becomes true, this guy will become the wise leader and he will lead the tribe. But in order to have these skills, he was able to predict the future. He used to have storytelling skills. This is very important in the big data age. This is a new technology called Magic Leap. It's a virtual reality technology. And as you can see in the screen, it is via the glass, it is transmitting a virtual image for you, and Google invested $500 million in this company, and this, as you can see, this image can interact with you via sensors, and it will detect your movement. So everything will be moved now from glasses, from the phones you are holding, to this virtual image. This video was introduced 1 week ago, and this technology is still secret. It's called Magic Leap. as you can see, the everything will be virtual now. We will reach to a point in our earth where we may no longer need a screen or a glass. We will interact with a virtual world. So with virtual reality, it will become the same as physical reality and involves all our senses. Then our sense maker will construct cosmopolitan narratives. We will be able to tell new stories. We will not be limited to the stories to where we are living now. We will be able to construct a new way of narratives. As you can see, this is a playground, and this fish in here, the shark in here. So we are moving to the age of being able to tell stories. Sense making, the ability to sense or trace everything, with data-driven storytelling will move you from the thoughts, belief and knowledge to experiencing and empathizing. We need to be empathizers. We need to be meaning makers. We need to be storytellers again. This is very important in the big data age. And we have now the data scientist. The data scientist, which Harvard Business Review said, is the sexiest job of the 21st century. The data scientists need to be curious. You need to have different kinds of skills like math, statistics, programming. You need to be a good communicator, and you need to be able to adapt to a data-driven culture. These are the important skills of a data scientist. But not all of us have a technical background or want to go with math or with programming. So how can we as humans or as citizens become modern data scientists? This is via sense-making, via storytelling. So these are the steps to help you get insights now. So you start with the unknown. Now we don't have predetermined questions, so start with unknown events or unknown data. We need to make use of our sense-making, how we sense things around us. Then we will use our curiosity. Curiosity is very important in order to get insights. Then we associate that with patterns. We draw the connections for all of that. Then if this information is novel or new, we will build a mental model. Then we'll be able to predict and tell stories. Let me give you some big data use cases. Let's go to sports. Germany was able to use big data to break Brazil's heart in the World Cup. They are able to analyze players' performance, the trainings of the Brazil team, and they are able to analyze all this data in order to improve the way they play football. So even big data is affecting sports. Insurance companies can now spot these unsafe drivers, so by putting sensors in the cars, data will be transmitted to a database, and it will be filtered with safe or unsafe drivers, and insurance companies can spot these drivers and will be able to cut costs. Moving to healthcare, there was a hospital in the UK that analyzed 1 million unstructured patient record data, and they did a natural language processing algorithms to analyze these texts, and then they were able to allocate resources more efficiently and neglect any unnecessary treatments. So we reach a point in our earth in healthcare where hospitals can predict the likelihood of you going to the hospital the next day. And we'll be able to analyze all the symptoms of diseases and discover new symptoms for our diseases. This is an example in journalism. This is a project we have done. When Nelson Mandela was dead, what we did is we analyzed around 500,000 tweets under RIP Nelson Mandela, and we visualized them in this map. And as you can see, the red ones are the huge traffic or the huge tweets in this area. So we discovered that there is a lot of traffic in Spain and in Indonesia. This was unusual for us. We did our research and we discovered that Indonesian people love Mandela because they used to go there and wear batik cloth, which is a traditional cloth in Indonesia. And Spain find or look at Mandela as a blessing because he gave them the World Cup in 2010. So we are able to get into these insights by visualizing data. This is transforming the way you do journalism. Moving to oil and gas. Now there is a trend in oil and gas where old employees or aging employees are retiring in the industry. So the industry wants to take this collective knowledge of these retiring engineers. How we can get all this knowledge from these retiring engineers? Now with big data, we can analyze well logs, which are written in longhand by these engineers. By doing natural language processing algorithm, you can extract the text, analyze it, and be able to build a collective intelligence system that will help you predict, recommend, and give it as a resource for the new engineers in oil and gas. Also moving to predicting crimes or visualizing crimes in real time. This is in New York City. You are able to visualize the crimes, predicting the crimes, and having this real-time image in the city. Also, when it comes to marketing, this paper was published by Parson in 1988. It was like predicting how marketing will be in the future. And with big data, all this are happening now. When it comes to interacting with the customer, with real-time interaction with the customer, personalization of offers. Also, when it comes to building recommendation engines for this customer, recommending for him a service in real time and where he is moving now or where he is sitting now. All these are also transforming marketing in the future. Moving to data for good, how we can use data for social good. There is a NGO in the US called DataKind that built this tool. There is a village in Africa, so are able to analyze satellite images and identify what are the houses with thatch roof and houses with iron roof. So are able to spot what are the wealthy population and what are the poor population in order to give them resources and provide them with help. So imagine how big data also is helping us to improve our world and making it much more better. Also, when it comes to social media and transportation planning, these are geotag tweets, and this is the map of Europe. And as you can see, these are the tweets in Europe, and transportation planning companies can be able to see what are the traffic using Twitter. Also, fashion and big data. Big data can be used in the fashion industry. There is a website called style.com, which is famous in the fashion industry. And you can now analyze the reviews in such websites and be able to spot who are the influential fashion designers. So by analyzing data from year 2000 and year 2014, they are able to know who are the most influential designers and who are the designers who are copying another designers. So even big data is disrupting the fashion industry. Also in telecoms. Telecom operators can now know who is influencing you to change from one operator to another operator, or moving from one operator to another operator. Also, this is a map for the news. So when it comes to Colombia, who is mentioning Colombia in the news? And who is mentioned by Colombia in the news? So by analyzing hundreds of newspapers online, by analyzing all this data, we are able to spot how the news is going worldwide. Also, this will improve our cities, will make it smart cities. These are the subway in Madrid, in Spain, and you can see these are the complaints by citizens. So if there is dirtiness in the subway, these are the complaints and visualized in real time in this map. And also you can identify the tourist patterns across the city and identify who are the tourists and who are the locals and see where are people moving in the city. These are geotagged tweets. So you can see the pattern flow of people and what are the interests of people when it comes to moving around in different touristic places in your city. And also in Dubai, now they are building such real-time transportation dashboards, which will show you in real time the transportation services, and this will be deployed in the streets of Dubai. When I said we are moving from predetermined questions or questions we don't know that we had before, this graph is for earthquake intensity. So what this company did, you know the wearable devices which you wear, which can track everything you do with your sleeping patterns and the calories you consume. So they were able to get the data of people sleeping in San Francisco when earthquake happened at that time. And based on on these sleeping patterns, and when people wake up in different areas in San Francisco, they are able to know the earthquake intensity based on sleeping patterns. These are kind of questions were not possible before, or we didn't have the chance to think about such correlation or questions in the past. So we are moving to a world of collective intelligence, where we as humans, as society, we as planetary intelligence will become much more smarter than any one of us by smart algorithms, by crowdsourcing, by streaming intelligence, by virtual reality, by visualizing all the networks and connections. All these are drivers for the planetary intelligence, where artificial intelligence will be the master in the future. Let me tell you a story before we end up our speech, which is called the Magical Soup Stone. There was a guy who was coming to a village. He was hungry, and he said that, "I want food." They told him, these people in this village are greedy, and they don't want to share. They won't share food with anybody. So it's better for you to go away and to check food in other villages. He said to them, "No, I don't need you. I have a magical stone, and I can build out of it a delicious soup." So he got to the center of the city. He put a pot, and he was able, and then he put the stone, and he said, "I'm building the magical soup." This soup is delicious. And then he said, "But I need some tomatoes, I need some spices." People started to share with him the food, and he was able to do this soup out of nothing. Then people started to ask him to buy the stone. So imagine how he was able to mash up different ingredients when comparing that to data, to mash up different data sets, how he built this culture of curiosity, of people who are curious to build this. So this is very important. The magical soup stone is very important in our big data age when it comes to cultures, when it comes to sharing our data. A final quote, the question will remain, can we do everything with nothing, with ephemeralization? Why not? In the future, we might not need a phone or a smartwatch at all. Thank you very much.